Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today, I'm thrilled to welcome back Dr. Gabor Maté. Dr. Maté is a world-renowned speaker. He's an authority on addiction and trauma and a best-selling author. His new book, written with his son, Daniel Maté, is called The Myth of Normal. It's amazing, and so is he. I hope you enjoy the conversation. Hi, Dr. Maté. How are you?
I'm very well. Thank you. Nice to see you, Tamara.
It's so good to see you. I got your book the other day. I have dug in. It's so good. I love this book. And although I'm not finished it yet, I think it might be my favorite of all your books.
Well, thank you.
How do you feel about this book?
Well, it was very tough to write. It took 10 years of research. As I think I may have told you, I collected 25,000 different scientific articles and journal papers and newspaper reports, read 200 or 300 books, interviewed 300 people, had them all transcribed. Then I had to fashion a book out of this mountain of material. And it was a tough process, and sometimes I actually lost heart that it is too big for me. But you know what? With the brilliant help of my son, Daniel, who was my co-writer, and 2.5 years of solid writing, I'm so happy with the result. It's the book I wanted to write. It's the book that I had originally conceived. And it just sums up what I know about human life, human health, human pathology, society, and how it's all one. We have to understand the individual. We have to look at the whole picture. It's the book I wanted to write.
I just feel... You know, when I saw that you had written this book with Daniel, it made me, it just felt so, there's something about when I saw both of your names on it, it just felt so good to me and so hopeful to me because, you know, to know that you have that relationship, that you can take on a project like this, right? This is huge, as you said. So much went into this book. What was that process like working with one of your kids?
So, as the book itself makes clear, when my children were small, my wife and I had a very troubled, loving, anyways, beautiful, but also very troubled and conflictual relationships. And Daniel talks in the book about how he had used to have this nightmare of the floor disappearing. Like all of a sudden the floor was not the floor, which meant that he never knew when the emotional atmosphere in the home would become unstable. So we've had a lot of stuff to work through. And we've done that a lot. The book itself was a way of working it through because when we began, I had a lot of my insecurities about writing the book. Daniel would make his suggestions and I'd be resistant. Then I'd be upset. And then when I get upset, that takes him back to childhood when his dad was upset, you know. So we had a lot of dynamics to work through. But we managed to evolve a very collegial, very friendly, very mutually respective, and also to be very fruitful way of working so that by the end, we would just bat the chapters back and forth and we'll make our little touches and we're both happy with it and then sign off on it. So it was a wonderful process.
Yeah. No kidding. I can see that. And from reading it, and I was so happy to meet him also because, you know, I hear you talk about your children and I see them on social media sometimes. And so it's just lovely. I think that you were able to do this together. When, you know, it's interesting when you say that you know, your kids had, you know, that you had challenges when your kids were young. And
yeah,
I think that a lot of people think that, oh, somebody like you would never would ever have any issues or challenges because this is what you do and you know how to do this stuff. You've written books on it.
Well, so for me to say that I've made every mistake in the book is literally I've made every mistake in my own books, number one. Number two, by the time I began to write books, I had learned a lot. And much of what I've learned had to do with the problems in my own family. And also my medical work, also my own therapy, my own work on myself. But by the time I wrote these books, the early years of my kids were over. So that it's not like I would make the same mistakes again. But in the when they were growing up, there was a lot I still had to learn. And much of what I've learned becomes expressed in my books. But some of that learning happened at their expense. That's just the truth.
Mm. What is the book is called The Myth of Normal. What is normal? Does normal exist?
Well, so there's a legitimate use for the word normal. So in medicine, for example, there's a normal range of blood pressure. There's a normal temperature of the body. It's a range, you know. There's a normal range of blood acidity. Outside that range, if it's too low or too high, we die. So that's the normal. In that case, normal is identical with healthy and natural. However, there's another use of the word normal, which is like everybody's doing it, so it's normal. It's like the norm. So to give you an egregious example, if everybody in Vancouver who had pets mistreated their pets, then mistreating your pets would be normal, but it would not be healthy or natural. And if you didn't mistreat your pets, you'd be abnormal by the standards of your society. So in that strict medical sense, normal is a really necessary usage, but in the broad sense, it's a myth. Because a lot of things that we think are normal in this society, in other words, which we assume have to be the way they are, and they're natural and healthy, are in fact neither the way they have to be, nor are they healthy, nor are they natural. And actually what I'm arguing, that much of what we take for normal in society is a source of pathology, physical and mental and emotional and spiritual. And so that when we call people abnormal, because they have some so-called pathology, what they're having is a normal response to an abnormal culture. So that if you imagine a scientist in a laboratory growing microorganisms in a petri dish, that brew would have to contain the nutrients and the elements necessary to keep that population of microbes healthy. If a lot of them started dying out or show pathology, you'd call that a toxic culture. Now, when you look at North American society, including Canada, more and more kids are being diagnosed with all manner of mental health conditions. Addiction deaths are going up. More people have died of overdoses in British Columbia than of COVID. Autoimmune rates are going up. Autoimmune disease rates are going up. Amongst the adult population, more and more people are taking medication. If our culture was like that laboratory dish, you'd have to say that it's a toxic culture. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm saying.
We hear about, you know, toxic people or a toxic situation or that group is toxic. I hear people say that word a lot. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I feel the toxic energy. Mm-hmm. You know, if I go on social media and I'm like, oh my gosh, this is like, it makes me feel, it can make me feel toxic.
Yes.
Is that, and I just feel like the whole, like, especially in the last 3 years, right? It's been very, like, this energy of, this toxic energy is everywhere, it seems.
That's one sense in which you use the word toxic, and it's absolutely true. But I think it goes way beyond that, because why has it become toxic? Like things just happen for no reason. Nothing happens for no reason. Sometimes we don't know the reason, but nothing happens for no reason. So why are things becoming more polarized? Why are people getting more toxified in their energies? Because there's more stress. So for example, during the COVID situation, the rate of child abuse went up. More kids ended up in emergency wards with injuries. Why? Because the parents were so stressed. And so then we have to ask, well, what are the conditions that stress people. Well, COVID was a clear kind of case example. People were fed economically threatened. They lost their usual outlets. They couldn't go to their football games or the pub or whatever social gatherings and so on. Now they took out their stresses on their kids. So COVID, the loneliness that the isolation imposed on people. But loneliness has been growing in a society for decades. More and more people are lonely now than they ever used to be. That has a negative impact on physical and mental health. The polarization that became evident, say, around the COVID debate, that was just a sign of an emotional polarization that's been growing in the society for a long time, which is inevitable when there's increasing inequality, where fewer people have more and more of the wealth, and more people are desperate not to lose their class status, let alone to even elevate it. When over 50% of women in 2017 in BC said they felt under severe economic stress, those conditions tend to create more extreme responses on the part of people. So it's not a moral failure or some mystery. The more stress the society experiences, the more you're going to see the splits and the fault lines.
And I think that's what you described it perfectly, because it does feel like the pandemic divided a lot of people. And it almost felt like the haves and the have-nots, right? Like some people's lives changed drastically and dramatically, and other people's lives didn't change at all.
Yeah, there was a slogan, we're all in this together, but we never were. So that the billionaire class in Canada gained multiple billions of dollars during COVID, while the rest of the population lost economically. We weren't all in this together. The people more prone to get COVID were people of color and the lower socioeconomic class. We weren't all in it together. People like me, you know, with secure middle-class existence, and I didn't have to leave home to make money. I could lecture to people online. In fact, it was good not to travel, because if I had to travel, I couldn't have finished this book. But other people lost their jobs. You can't be a construction worker online. You can't be an oil rig worker or a fisherman online, you know. So we were never in this unequal society. We were never all in this together. Now, COVID itself, of course, was only a highlighting of tendencies that have been going on in society forever. So it's not that COVID created the splits. It revealed them, is what it did. We have to drop our illusions about this lovely together democratic society that we live in. It's neither lovely nor together nor democratic. It's very unequal, and that creates all kinds of stresses for people.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned loneliness, and that's one thing that I really noticed during the last 3 years is, you know, I have 3 kids, a husband, there's 4 animals in my house. There were times when I felt so lonely. And I couldn't put my finger on it. Like, how could I be lonely, yet I'm surrounded by people? I couldn't figure it out. And I know that I'm not alone in that feeling.
You're not alone in your loneliness. As somebody said, we've never been so alone altogether, you know? Well, I don't know what was going on for you, but I could make a general guess, which is that one of the chapters in The Myth of Normal is entitled Society Shocks Absorbers, referring to women. And there was an article in the New York Times that actually called women society shock absorbers. So women who in this culture that we can fairly call patriarchal took on the emotional responsibility of their families and of themselves and everybody else. And they even felt guilty that their husbands or their children were stressed, because it was supposed to be the job of the woman to absorb and take care of all the stress. Now, I don't know if you did all that, Tamara, but if you did, you were very alone with it. You know, and my question is, when you felt so alone with it, who did you ask for help? And I said, yeah. Well, where does that leave you? Feeling totally alone. That leaves you totally alone. And that dynamic of women absorbing all the stress and being alone with it, It's a deep source of illness, which is why women have 70 or 80% of autoimmune disease in this culture, because they take it all on. But then the question is, and I'm not going into an analysis of your marriage or situation, but if you didn't ask for help, that tells me about your relationship, or it tells me about how you relate to that relationship and a kind of unconscious agreement that men make with women, or vice versa, which is that one gender will absorb the stresses of the other, you know, and let's not talk about it. So
interesting. I was going to ask you if,
So your aloneness, aloneness doesn't come from having people around or not having them around. Aloneness is how open and myself can I be when other people are around. I can be totally lonely in a crowd of 1,000 people where I don't show up as my real self. So they don't see me. Well, then I'm totally alone.
I was going to ask you if men and women experience trauma differently, or if they, I don't know if I'm wording that properly, but you're describing something right now. And so when I think about, you know, trauma that comes from childhood or trauma that comes from, I mean, it comes from all different places. Do men and women experience it differently?
They seem to deal with it differently. And that has to do with how we are acculturated. Like, men are not supposed to be vulnerable. They're not supposed to be weak. They're not supposed to have feelings. Now, of course, as human beings and as animals, of course they have feelings. Of course they're vulnerable. But if there's some cultural injunction against experiencing it or talking about it, and you have to be sort of strong and tough about it, that's going to impose a real burden on you, which you're going to act out. Now, men tend to act out their trauma. How do they act it out? By aggressing against their women, by being violent with other men, and by being violent with themselves, which is why men tend to commit suicide more than women do. Women tend to act it out. Act it in. So not so that they absorb the stresses of others. They push down their feelings. They're more likely to get depressed and take antidepressants. They take on the anxiety of others. So women are given double the amount of anxiety pills than men are. And women also, because of their repression of their emotions, to take care of everybody else, are much more likely to get chronic illness than men do. So the trauma, the wound, might be very similar, but how it's dealt with, I should say how it's not dealt with, shows up differently in the two genders based on cultural expectations. So, and you know, the worst thing, what's the worst thing you can say about a guy? The biggest insult you can give a guy is to call him according to the female genitalia, not according to the male genitalia. Well, that terrifies guys. Mm. You know, so this shows you the difference.
Wow. Yeah, it's a good point. When you have a, you talk about society, how society breeds disease.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's, yeah, I mean.
Well, a million ways. Well, for one thing.
Yeah, a million ways.
It's more like how it does not. So here we have the wealthiest societies in the history of the world. And we have all this chronic illness. I mean, despite the fact that we have the most advanced medicine, well, there's two things going on. One is that society generates stresses, and stresses make people ill. Chronic stress makes people ill. So the major triggers for stress, according to the research, is uncertainty, lack of information, conflict, and loss of control. Now, how many people in society are living with loss of control? How much control do you have when some corporation 10,000 miles away can decide whether you have a job or not? And you never know what's going to happen. You know? Or people who you don't even know get to make decisions that will destroy the climate so that there's going to be a flood or a heat dome in Vancouver or in British Columbia. And you have no input whatsoever. So there's a total loss of control. There's uncertainty. because amidst all the wealth, now Canada has right now, what is it, an 8% inflation rate, 7-8%? That means that unless you get an 8% raise, you're going to have less money a year from now than you do now. And maybe already you're struggling. Then there's the housing crisis where a lot of people just can't even dream of owning a house anymore. But there's a lot of uncertainty. Well, that translates into physiological stress. It's not just sort of an emotional turmoil. It has an impact on your heart, on your blood pressure, on your hormones, on your immune system, on your gut, on your nervous system. So stress makes people sick. Chronic stress makes people sick. That stuff, that research was done here in Canada in the 1930s. Stress itself was coined as a phrase by a researcher working in Canada, who was like me, was from Hungary. His name was Janos or Hans Selye, and he's the one that coined the word stress. And he's the one that showed in the laboratory what stress does to the organisms. So this society breeds a lot of stress. Then, how we raise children, how we even gestate children. Stress on pregnant women already has a negative impact on the genetic functioning of infants, which you can measure 40 years later. Stress on pregnant women has an impact on how a child's brain develops, which you can measure. And how are we looking after pregnant women? The average physician doesn't even know what I'm talking about because it's not in their training. So when you go to you've got kids. When you went to the doctor for your prenatal visits, anybody ask you about stress in your life?
No, absolutely not.
Anybody ask you how your relationship
was? And I was probably at my highest stress.
Anybody ask you about how your relationship with your spouse was going?
No.
Well, all that would
never
have
never been asked any of those things.
That's the whole point. Yet all those facts would have an impact on your child in utero. Then there's birth. In British Columbia, there's a 40% cesarean section rate, almost. Now, cesarean sections are life-saving essential interventions 10 to 15% of the time. We've medicalized birth, and birth is meant not to be just a mechanical process of pushing the baby out of the womb, but of bonding. Birth has a biochemical broth that's released in mother and infant. It's called a love cocktail of oxytocin and endorphins, and that's meant to prepare them for the bonding, at the end of which, when the baby emerges, they're meant to be put on the mother's breast and they start suckling right away. Just look at animals. We give birth mostly in hospitals with mechanical machines, whirring and buzzing and making noises, lights, instruments, fetal monitoring. We're always looking for pathology in a totally normal process. So we've taken medical vigilance to the extreme so that now we're actually not even letting people have a normal experience of the most normal thing in their lives. And again, I'm not here to denounce modern obstetrics, which for God's sakes can and has saved a lot of lives. I'm saying we've overdone it. We've become too mechanized, mechanical. That's just birth. Then there's the parenting advice that people get. Sleep train the baby. Don't pick them up when they're crying. Now you tell a mother baboon to ignore the cries of their infant, or a mother cat, or a mother bear. See what that's going to get you. But human parents are told to ignore the child's needs, because the child is crying because they need something, and they need you. That's why indigenous cultures, kids were never even put down. I talked to a Cree woman who said that in our culture, kids never even touched the ground for the first 2 years. In hunter-gatherer groups, where we evolved as human beings for millions and hundreds of thousands of years, children were carried everywhere by the parents. They need that physical touch for emotional development.
Of course.
And then we tell parents, if your two-year-old is angry, make them sit by themselves. Teach the kid that they're acceptable to you only under condition that they please you. That's a terrific way to make a child feel insecure. Then we wonder why there's so many kids with mental health issues. So, I mean, look, I could go on forever. Then there's the regimented school education that values curriculum teaching much more than human intellectual and emotional development. The job of the school shouldn't be to teach facts. It should be to promote development. Kids who are emotionally developed and intellectually developed, they will learn easily and willingly. So, I mean, we get it all.
And I think that, I'm listening to you say these things and compare it to my experience of, birthing three children.
Yeah.
And, I have to admit that when I was pregnant, especially the first time, I'd never been pregnant before. I didn't know what to expect. I was given a book, What to Expect When You're Expecting. And
I was told
that I had to go for this test and do this and do that and do this. And you have to do this and you need to buy these things. And it's all coming at me from apps and every woman coming at them from every single angle about what you should be doing.
Yeah.
Is capitalism there's so many rules now about everything, but I'm not even sure who's making the rules anymore.
Well, see, what was missing there is, let's just acknowledge something. I've alluded to it before. We evolved as human beings in small band hunter-gatherer groups. As a woman growing up, you would have seen pregnant women. You would have seen them get bigger. You would have seen the tribe take care of them. You would have seen the birth. You would have seen the breastfeeding. You would have seen other women supporting the pregnant woman. But this is not just human beings, by the way. Do you know how elephants give birth? When an elephant mother goes into labor, the mother elephants stand around in a circle. And when the infant elephant hits the ground, they all reach out with their trunks and they stroke the infant. It was a communal event. So in today's isolated, so what you're describing is a function of the isolation and the denaturation of human experience in our particular very synthetic culture. Now, in the absence of innate knowledge, then we have to rely on experts. There is a parenting instinct. If you don't think there's a parenting instinct, look at a mother baboon, okay? Or look at a mother whale. We human beings have them as well. But instincts have to be evoked by the environment. They don't work on their own. So in an environment that doesn't evoke the parenting instinct, in fact, even suppresses it. Like when you tell them, I don't know if you ever tried to sleep train a baby, but when you talk to young parents who are following the sleep training advice of ignore the baby's cries, what's happening to the parent when that's going on? Their heart is breaking. Their heart is breaking because every instinct in them wants to pick up that crying child. But the expert says, no, don't do that. I've known mothers who go into the shower and put their hands in their ears not to hear the baby's crying when the baby's being sleep trained. So actually our instincts are shut down by a lot of the parenting advice that people receive. And because we no longer grow up in a natural environment where we see parenting happening, then we feel it's like a skill we have to learn. But it's not a skill, it's a relationship. And we've lost the relationship.
We have to buy a book on how to be pregnant.
Yeah, yeah.
It's when I say that out loud,
yeah,
it's absurd.
Yeah, or how to be a parent.
Absolutely absurd. Yeah, how to be a parent.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting.
So I know that you're familiar with the book that I wrote with Gore Neufeld, Hold On to Your Kids. Our whole intention in that book is not to teach parents how to parent, but to return parents to their actual instincts.
Yeah.
And that's my intention.
We know.
And that's my intention with this book as well. It's not so much here's what you do, but here's where you lost your connection with yourself and your instincts, and here's how to get back to it.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I noticed about this book is that everything feels familiar to me in a different way. I can't put into words exactly how to describe that, but it feels familiar to me. Like, oh wait, I actually know this. I know this. It's like I need this reminder that's in here of how to almost like. How to figure, like, I think are we not all searching for who we really are? Like,
yeah, we are. We are searching.
If someone asked me, yeah, who I am. I don't know if I could answer that right now.
Well, that's a good thing, because any answer you come up with would be false. Any answer you come up with would be false. It'd be based on roles and ideas and so on. Not knowing who you are is a great state to be in, because it means you're going to be curious and trying to experience it. The best compliment I ever got was from a young man who came to one of my retreats, and he said, "Thank you, I remembered myself." So that what you're saying about, you read this book and it feels familiar. When you're reading the book, what I'm hearing is that you're remembering yourself. So just keep paying attention.
Go ahead. No, I feel that's exactly what I feel when I say it feels familiar. I feel like, oh, right, this is. I will say, I feel like this book came at the perfect time for me. Not to, you know, and I think that most people that I know, a lot of people are very excited about this book and to read this book. And I think because we needed this from you. You know what I mean? Like we needed this from you to remind us to be familiar with, you know,
ourselves.
You know, because I think that sometimes.
Yeah. Go ahead. Sorry. No, you go ahead.
I was going to say, I think that sometimes the big block that some of us have, or I know I can speak for myself on this one, is that we compare trauma sometimes.
Yeah.
A lot. Where I hear someone else's trauma and I think to myself, oh, well, mine isn't that bad, so I have nothing to complain about. Or this person's trauma is way more intense than mine, so maybe I don't actually have trauma. Maybe I just need to, you know.
Well, let's put that to a test, okay?
Okay.
Let's put it to a test. Let's say tomorrow I come to you and I say, my name is Gabor, and I'm suffering from such and such, and this is what happened to me. Naturally, you would say to me, hey, compared to what some people have suffered, that's nothing. Get over it. Is that what you'd say to me?
Never. I would never say that to you.
Why wouldn't you say it?
Why wouldn't I say it? Because obviously it's traumatizing to you, and so I respect that.
It's also traumatizing to say it to yourself. So you have a double standard here. You treat me much more kindly than you treat yourself. And so that double standard of treating yourself less kindly than me is a sign of trauma itself. Because that's what happens to people, is they start to get down on themselves. And later in the book, I know chapters you haven't got to yet, we actually talk about that very dynamic. Or let me give you another example. Let's say some child comes to you and says, not your child, but some friend's child comes to you that says, you know, Auntie Tamara, my daddy's yelling at my mommy and I feel so bad. Naturally, you would say to them, oh, come on, there's kids starving all over the world. What are you complaining about? Is that what you say to them?
I personally would never say that.
Well, of course you wouldn't, but you're saying it to yourself. But when you say to yourself that my trauma is not as bad as others, so what?
That's what I'm saying to me.
So what? Yes. Well, that's just a lack of compassion for yourself. And so it's worth noticing, not to make it wrong, but just notice it.
Or am I protecting myself from my trauma?
Well, you
might be. Do I belittle my trauma to make myself feel better? You know, do people do that? Do they belittle their trauma?
They do, because they'd rather hold on to the illusion, and they also don't want to really deal with what really happened in their lives.
Right.
So, right. But it's not compassionate one way or the other.
True. Do you talk about authenticity, what it means to be authentic, your authentic self.
Yeah.
That's hard to find.
Is it? Have you ever been?
I think so.
Have you ever been inauthentic, as far as you know?
No.
You've never been inauthentic?
I don't think so.
Have you ever pretended to agree with something when you didn't?
Yes. Yes.
Have you ever wanted help, but you didn't ask for it?
Yes.
You've been inauthentic.
Yes, of course.
Do you want your kid to be not asking for help when they need help? Do you want your child to trust their true opinion for the sake of being accepted by others?
No, but I parent my children very different.
I know. I'm not.
Talking about, I was parented.
But I'm not talking about how you treat your children.
Right.
I'm talking about how you treat yourself. Okay.
Interesting.
Somebody say, have you ever been authentic? No. Sure, you have.
Yeah.
You know, and you just have to notice it, not as a criticism of yourself, but as a compassionate understanding of yourself. Well, why on earth would I be an inauthentic? Why do you want your kids to be authentic?
Yeah.
Why do you want your children to be authentic? Why?
Because I know that when you are confident and loving of yourself and you are your true self, that you live a peaceful life in your being.
Yes.
That's how I feel. And I feel like, you know, I want that for my children.
Yeah, and I totally agree.
I want my children to feel love, you know, and kindness, and they do, because it's been a very conscious effort.
Because they have received it. And I totally agree with your definition of an authentic life, okay? Trouble is, there's so many ways that this society discourages that authentic life. We're supposed to fit in and be like others and like the same things and buy the same products. And when we don't feel well, rather than looking at, well, why am I not feeling well? Let's just buy another object or do another activity to get away from those feelings, you know, so that this society thrives on inauthenticity.
We've had a conversation before. I think it was over a year ago now, and on this podcast, and we talked about trauma and we talked about disease. And I told you I had cancer and you know, it was a really, it changed the way that I looked at the disease that I had and why it happened. I was told it was bad luck, and I agreed with that. It was bad luck. But after my conversation with you, and you asked me about my childhood, and when I read more and I listened to more things, listened to you talk more, I have no doubt now that the reason I had cancer was because of trauma. I know that for a fact now.
Well, that's a...
And
sorry, go ahead.
You know, I was just going to say, like, and then I read, I saw chapter 27, which is disease as a teacher.
Yeah.
And it really hit me. That you know, that really sat with me and made me think about what my disease taught me and if it taught me anything or if I buried that too. And, you know, it really changed. That conversation changed everything for me because I just looked at it as bad luck.
Yeah, I understand.
And I realized I have so much more healing to do, right?
But look, so in that conversation, I would have asked you if you've ever repressed your feelings, if you were good with healthy anger, and you would have said, yes, I've repressed my feelings and I'm not very good with healthy anger. Is that about accurate? Okay.
Yeah, that's accurate, yes.
But look, Tamara, this is how the mind works. Because 20 minutes ago, I asked you if you've ever been authentic, and you said no. But you lived all your life inauthentically by suppressing your feelings and serving the needs of others and not recognizing your own and not expressing healthy anger. And it seems like you've already forgotten that conversation. When I asked you if you've ever been authentic, you said, no, I haven't. Now, this is not a criticism. It's just to point out.
I know.
It's just to point out that these habits are so difficult to work through and to let go of, you know, and they kind of automatically reassert themselves. So it just means that you got that much more work to do. That's all it means.
Yeah.
So sometimes under the pressure of some misfortune, we want to learn and we kind of open up. And then when things start going better again, we kind of forget what we've learned and we go back to our old ways. I mean, that's been my pattern. It's probably your pattern as well. That's why we have to keep waking up. Let's hope that it's not disease that wakes us up, you know?
Yes. Yes. And that's what you mean by disease as a teacher too, right? It's like, is it teaching us something or is it...
It can.
Or do we have to learn again, I guess?
Well, right? It can. And the examples I give in the book are people that really learned. But notice that the main title of that chapter is A Dreadful Gift. Diseases teach. Mm. It's a dreadful way to have to learn. Mm-hmm. Now, some people, incredibly, have taken terminal illness or disease that was thought to be terminal or serious health challenges, and they learned from them, and they continue to learn from them. I know people with multiple sclerosis that continue to learn from their disease. How? When they have a flare-up, they look at what stresses they imposed on themselves. Oh, and as soon as they do, the symptom goes away. Same with rheumatoid arthritis. So the disease can be a teacher. I don't recommend it.
No.
That people learn that way, but it can be looked upon that way.
I know we have to wrap up. I wanted to ask you before we go, though. I watched The Wisdom of Trauma.
Oh, yeah.
And I loved it. And it was so, again, I mean, I need these reminders from you all the time. I think that there's millions of people out there that, you know, this is what we appreciate from you is these reminders that come, you know, like the wisdom of trauma that when that documentary was released.
By the way, that's still still available online, by the way. You just look for The Wisdom of Trauma. You can still watch it online. But, you know, Tamara, what I tell you, though, is I need the reminders, too. And it's
this makes me feel so much better.
Yeah. Well, it's just the truth.
I was going to ask you, like, are you all done? Are you all, like, you know everything, but when you say that you need the reminders too?
I need the reminders too.
I always think there's a finish line, right?
Yeah, there is.
Like, oh, I'm gonna be healed one day.
There's a finish line. When they lower you into the ground and they cover you up, that's the finish line.
I knew you were going to say that. That's not the finish line I meant. I meant like, hey, I'm my authentic self and I know who I am I have all this wisdom.
Well, I'm a lot closer to it than I used to be. And when I lose it, I'm much quicker to be able to come back to it. Life feels a lot lighter this way than it used to. But I need the reminders, and life has a way of reminding us. In a spat with my wife, or a rift with one of my children, or the fatigue that I feel sometimes. I get these reminders too, and we all need them. You know, now I'm in a fortunate position to be able to articulate things in a way that people seem to appreciate and that they learn from. But none of us are above the processes that I describe. I'm certainly am not.
I really appreciate you taking the time to have this conversation. And I just want to remind everybody that the book is called The Myth of Normal, and it is by Dr. Maté and his son, Daniel. And you are going out on your big book launch, and everybody needs to read this book. It is one of those books that, you know, you just... can pick up and open it up anywhere and just start reading. There will be something that really, I mean, every page has a different meaning on it for me. So I really appreciate your time here. Your Twitter is Dr. Gabor Maté, and same with Instagram, and same with your, thank goodness you have all the same website, Instagram, and Twitter.
Thank you so much. I think Instagram is Gabor Maté.
Oh, you've got MD.
Gabor Maté, MD.
Yeah, you're right. You've got MD.
I don't know these things because other people manage. I don't manage these things. I never tweeted.
You're not doing your social media?
I've never. I don't know. I don't even know how to. But it seems to happen anyway. So listen, I appreciate this opportunity to talk about this book that is within 4 days of being published, and it was a work of a lifetime. And so to have a enthusiastic response and an opportunity to introduce it to more people. I really cherish that. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.